Hello and welcome. My name is Walid Mir. I'm a Microsoft Technical Trainer here to walk through the Microsoft SC-300 Identity and Access Administrator Associate course with you. Imagine a scenario. An employee leaves the organization, but their account remains active, posing a security risk. Or maybe a cyber attack targets weak passwords and you need to act fast to protect your users. What if you could instantly disable risky accounts, enforce strong password policies, and automatically lock out attackers before they even get in? That's the power of Microsoft Entra's account protection features. In this session, you'll discover how disabling accounts, implementing password protection, and leveraging Smart Lockout can help you stay one step ahead of the threats and keep your organization secure without slowing down your users. So let's get started. Let's start talking about disabling user accounts and how we revoke user sessions. Now, there might be times that you might need to disable user account, or you need to revoke their existing user sessions based on different scenarios. For instance, there is some sort of a security risk that's associated to user account, and you might need to temporarily disable the user account and revoke all their active sessions. Now, when a user authenticate themselves to Entra, typically they get access to two different tokens. Now, these tokens are allocated to the user, and this is typically what we refer as an access token, which is typically valid for 1 hour. Along with an access token, they also receive a refresh token. So when the access token expires after an hour, they quietly go back and refresh these tokens and get a new access token and a refresh token for the user, without having for the user to re-authenticate again and again. However, if there's a need for me to disable user accounts for whatever reasons, I should be able to go into my Entra and disable the user account. But if they already have an active access token working, that could mean that there might be some delays before you can stop them from using different services. Now, let's have a quick discussion on what we can do to avoid some of these scenarios. First of all, if you're using an Entra environment, you should be able to go into the user profile and simply disable their account. You can hit reset password for their account and then disable any other associated resources such as any tokens or any devices that they might be working on that allows them to authenticate. Now, if you are looking to do this using command line options, then you can look at some PowerShell scripts that are on the screen that you should be aware of on how you can implement some of these changes. Now, in this case, we have two different scenarios. One, if you're using a scenario where you're working with a user that's on-prem, then in that case, you should be able to go and disable their user account and then reset their password. One thing that's important to remember, for users that are in a hybrid state, you might be required to reset their password twice. Now, this is just to avoid any hash-based attack process being carried out on the user account. Now, simply to avoid hashing style attacks, you reset their password twice. So if there's any cache of that password hash lingering about, you should be able to push that to ensure that that account simply gets disabled immediately. However, for Entra users, you can simply disable the account, revoke their session, and start to reset their account if you wanted to. Now let's jump onto the portal and have a look at some of these settings. All right, I'm back onto my Entra portal using entra.microsoft.com. And in my Entra admin center, all I'm going to do is jump onto my users to find a user that I need to disable. Now, I will find one of the users that I've been working with on this series called Frank, and we'll go into Frank's profile and start looking at Frank's account. So as I get into Frank Adams' profile, I can see that right on the main and the overview of the page, we have their account status, which is currently enabled. And I can simply go onto the top of the screen and look at the password reset option. That's available for me to reset their password. So I can trigger manual password reset for them and hit the reset button. For me to disable their account, all I'll need to do is click on edit account status and simply go and uncheck this box that says account enabled. Now, by unchecking that box, we are actually disabling this account. And if I hit save to this, now this will turn the status of this account to be disabled. And this is how you disable a user account. Now, if I go back up on the top, like we mentioned before, by disabling the account, any further authentications are not going to happen. However, if they have any active sessions currently running with an active token right now, authentication token, access token right now, then you can simply revoke them by simply hitting revoke sessions. And this will revoke all sessions that they have, requiring them to re-sign into their resources again. Now, again, this is how you can simply force that to ensure that the user currently doesn't have access to any of the resources that they're working on. Now, along with talking about disabling user accounts in Entra and managing user accounts, we can also look at implementing password protection for your users. Now, for password protections, again, this is something very interesting to understand, that on-prem, you might have loads of different types of password policies that you might be working with to ensure that you can have a better strength on a password, so people are not using weak passwords, a minimum character length, and all sorts of similar other policies that you might find on-prem. Now, in Entra, you will look at something similar that we can implement in our environment to ensure that we can have some sort of password protection enabled in our environment. Now, to do this, let's jump back onto the portal one more time and have a look at some of the options for password protection. So I'm back onto my portal and back onto entra.microsoft.com in Entra Admin Center. And all I'm going to do is scroll down the blade to authentication methods. And within authentication methods, we can have a look at password protection option that's listed under the authentication method policies. Now, within this, you can see that we have an option right over here to look at custom band passwords that we can implement in our environment. Now, by default, Microsoft manages a list of what we refer as globally banned passwords. Now, these globally banned passwords is a knowledge base of Microsoft keeping a track of all type of weak passwords for over the last 50 years and making sure that people don't reuse them. A lot of this information is added along with other security organizations that Microsoft collaborates with, for the likes of CIS and many others that are out there. Using that, we create a long list of passwords that are weak. Passwords like password 123, with loads of different variations in it. Or looking at QWERTY on your keyboard, or keeping ABCDEF, or something similar. So knowing all of those as a globally, or labeling all of them as globally known or banned passwords, Microsoft doesn't allow you to keep any of those in your environment. Now, along with that, you can simply look at adding other passwords to the list of your organization where people might not be able to keep them. Now, typically, when you look at someone who's not good at creating passwords, they would look around themselves or the resources that they work with to create their passwords. For instance, the team that you're in, the project that you're working on, the product that your company creates or produces, or a service that you use, maybe the device that you work on. So they look at similar other brand names, company names, and details like that to create the passwords. Now, if you are aware of some of that information, you can simply come in here and start adding that to your passwords in your environment. Now, in here, we can start looking at implementing a custom banned password list. This is a list that you are going to look at managing in your environment. Now, the custom banned password list, if you want to enable it, simply switch it on. And here we can add up to 1,000 words as a part of the list over here to ensure people can't keep them or use them as passwords. Now, there is a documentation that explains the details about them. Let's quickly jump onto the Learn portal, Learn documentation to find out some information about this. All right, just jumping onto the Learn portal, learn.microsoft.com. And in here, I'm simply going to look for documentation, and we are searching for custom broadband password list. And if I see there's a document that's available for me to look at, we can try that. Let's go into this document. Now, we are going to look at working with custom end passwords. Now, again, this is a good document if you've never implemented a custom band password in your environment. You can follow this document through to understand how that works. What I am going to look at is explaining on how we can eliminate weak passwords in the cloud using password protection. Now, in this document, if I scroll down right at the bottom, it talks about the globally banned password list that I mentioned earlier on that Microsoft manages for you to ensure people are not using commonly used passwords that are non-worldwide, so we avoid using them. Along with that, what you can do in your organization is implement a custom banned password list. Now, within this, you can start adding different words that you think are useful for your environment. Things like I mentioned before, your product name, service, your departments, your organization name, all those can be added as part of that list. What this particularly does is looks at a 5-point based system to ensure that people who are creating their passwords can qualify for a tougher or stricter password rather than keeping a password weak. So just by on its own, contoso exclamation one would not work, simply because if you look at the list over here, they've already added contoso as one of the words that is banned. Now, what typically happens is it looks at a password that you choose and it goes through a few stages. Now, these stages are defined in this documentation very well. And if you are interested to read through some of this, you can go through understanding this. So it normalizes the password first. So anything that you use, for example, if someone thinks password 123 with a variation of at in there, dollar signs and W0RD exclamation one makes it a strong password, then maybe not. In this case, you look at this password protection or custom and password list will normalize all your letters or characters that you use. So converting anything like a dollar to an S, at to an A, zero to an O, and one to an L. So it converts them all to a normal word. So it removes anything that you've used as a assuming adding characters to your password. And then it goes back into checking your password details that you've added in there. Now, typically the 5-point based system that I mentioned, it simply verifies that you have cleared enough to make your password strong. So if you have a matching word to the word that you have on the banned list, you qualify for 1 point. So if somebody goes in and creates a password a bit like this, now in this case, if I have both Contoso and London in my password banned list, this typically will qualify for 1 point for Contoso, 1 point for at, and 1 point for London. So this qualifies for 3 points. So it doesn't meet the minimum 5-point criteria that we have. So it will simply come back with an error message suggesting the password that you're choosing is weak. Please reset your password to something stronger. And again, if you want to look at this, this document goes into a bit more detail explaining different scenarios and examples in how you can ensure that it calculates that 5-point based system to allow people to create a secure password. Now, let's jump back onto the portal. In here, again, we can add all the terms and terms that we need. Like I said, your company name, obviously an actual name, rather than me defining them. Department. You could have your team. You could have your project. You could have your product. You could have the services that you provide and many other things. Things that you think might be commonly used in your organization for a weak password. So you can add them all in here to ensure people come up with a combination of different things to make your password secure. Now, if you're looking to implement this on a hybrid environment and you have a hybrid environment currently set up, all you need to do is come in here and enable this feature right over here to ensure that your users can on-prem can also utilize the same feature, and it helps them push the password protection for any Windows server running on Active that has your Active Directory running in it. So it can ensure all users under Active Directory on-prem can also have this password policy pushed on for them. Now, we have two different statuses for this particular password protection. We can leave this under audit, and that could be a good way for you to understand if you want to monitor how many people are using weak passwords, then this audit mode could help you with that. It will help you in understanding how many weak passwords people are attempting to use, and it will warn you as many times as people are trying to keep their weak password. Now, the audit mode doesn't actually stop them from keeping it. However, it'll warn you and tell you on how many people in your organization might have a weak password. So this gives you a quick indication overall in terms of coming with maybe some more training to your staff to ensure they understand what a weak password looks like and how they can improve on that. Once you have onboarded all your staff and team members to understand strong passwords, maybe you can enforce this. Once this is enforced, people won't be able to keep weak passwords, and they will simply be given an error message suggesting they need to change their password for something stronger than what they've already used. Now, another feature that you see within the password protection is called the Smart Lockout. Now, Smart Lockouts, just like many other solutions on-prem for the lockout features, you must have seen something similar where a user tries to attempt multiple times to log in, and after a few failed attempts, their account gets locked out. Now, this Smart Lockout is something similar, but it's a little bit smart in the sense that it starts giving or allows users to attempt the same password multiple times. If the password remains the same and it's incorrect, it simply generates hash values for every password, and as long as the hash value is the same, it counts that as one attempt. For instance, I type my password in once, I hit enter, I get an error message saying password incorrect. Maybe I'll try slow down and type my password in again, and I hit enter, and I get an error message again saying my password is incorrect. Now, in both cases, my password that I typed in was the same, so the hash value for that password would still be the same, so it still counts that as one. However, if I start now rethinking and start changing my password to say, maybe there's another one to this, or maybe there was a different character at the end or start, that becomes a different word, and the hash value for that would be different, so it will count that as a new attempt. So again, not saying that this smart feature would not lock you out. It would lock you out if you attempt multiple different types of passwords. Now, this is another way of protecting you from password spray-like attacks that could happen against your account. However, if somebody genuinely has forgotten their password, or if it's typing in incorrectly without looking at the keyboard, or the caps lock is stuck in, then they might not be locking themselves out as quickly as that. As soon as they realize their password is not correct and they fix that, they should be able to log back in. Now, on the Smart Lockout policies that we have built under the password protection, the lockout threshold is by default set to 10. Now, for secure environments, you might want to change that to less than that. So if people attempt multiple wrong passwords, their account locks out a bit quicker than 10 attempts, or maybe something that you can manage in your organization, depending on what you prefer. Now, once their account is locked out, the duration their account is locked out currently by default is 60 seconds. For 60 seconds, this screen will wait for them before they can try again into logging in. Now, after that 60 second has gone by, every other attempt that they perform to log back in with a wrong password attempt, this time automatically increments. Now, we can't control the incrementing of the time. That's something that's managed by Microsoft for you, and it keeps on delaying that as a delayed tactic to avoid any password spray attacks that could be happening on that user account. And with that, we come to the end of the session. We encourage you to review the reference modules, check your knowledge with the additional study materials, watch other videos in this course, or search out your next favorite topic on Microsoft Learn at aka.ms/learn. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next video.